طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. I'm sorry for the delay as we I'm not sure if you are aware that we the صلاة المغرب now it's become later than before. Therefore, I just suggest for us that if it's okay, we start next week at 7:15 instead of 7 o'clock. So, you know, I can come back from the masjid also, brothers, if they are, you know, there's in the masjid, so they can come and we can, you know, start our class easily, inshallah. So please, Brother Abdul Majid, if you make announcement, inshallah, for next week, it will be, inshallah, at 7:15 instead of 7 PM. Barakallah fikum. طيب بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Let's start first. I'm to share with you the book so we can read together and then we can explain. طيب. Is it clear, يا عبد المجيد؟
Yes,
Sheikh.
Yeah, if you can scroll it up, please.
Yes, alhamdulillah. Can you see it now?
Yes. Abu Qatadah Al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked about fasting on the day of Arafah, the ninth of the month of Dhul Hijjah. He replied, fasting on the day of Arafah is an expiation for the preceding year and the following year. He was also asked about fasting on the day of Ashura, the 10th of the month of Muharram. He replied, fasting on the day of Ashura is an expiation for the preceding year. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was also asked about fasting on Monday, and he replied, this is the day on which I was born, and the day on which I was sent with the message of Islam, and the day on which I received revelation, related by a Muslim.
Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi man wala. Explaining this hadith, as you notice, this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were asked about three different days about fasting them, three different days. And here we are talking about the optional fasting, voluntarily fasting, because as we know all, that the only obligatory fasting for a Muslim is the fasting of the month of Ramadan. Any other fasting other than Ramadan is what? Is considered as voluntarily and optional fasting. So the Messenger of Allah was asked about these 3 days, which means how about fasting in them, or what's the ruling of fasting during these days. The first one was he was asked about the fasting the day of Arafah. The day of Arafah. What does it mean, the day of Arafah? We know that Arafah is the place near Mecca, where the pilgrimage they go, and one of the arkan al-hajj, one of the pillars of hajj, is to stand or stay on the place called Arafah. So when we said fasting the day of Arafah, that means fasting during the day where it is the date is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, where the Hujjaj, the pilgrimage, are in Arafat, which means what about fasting this day? What is the ruling? What is the reward? So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered them. And he said that fasting the day of Arafat will be a way of an expiation for the preceding year and the following year. That's mean 2 years. 2 years. And the year which the Prophet ﷺ talk about it now, does it start with the calendar? I mean, with Muharram, which is the first month of the year is Muharram. No, it's started, I mean, from the same day of Arafah. That's mean from the day of Arafah to the next Arafah, this is 1 year. So this is the way, that's mean, so 2 years, the day before and the year before and the year after. And then the question was about another day, which is the day of Ashura. The day of Ashura. What is the meaning of Ashura? Ashura, that's mean the 10th. The 10th. And this referring to the 10th day of Muharram. And Muharram is the first month in the Muslim calendar. Muharram is the first month in the Islamic year. So the Ashura, in fact, is the day, the 10th day of the month of Muharram. And you know the story that the Prophet ﷺ, he came to Medina and he found the Jew, they are fasting this day. And he said, why you are doing this? And they said, this is the day where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa alayhi salam and his followers from the Pharaoh. So we praise Allah, we're giving thanks to Allah Azza wa Jal by fasting this day. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is the day. In fact, we are more near to Musa than you. And we have more rights. Why? Because he's, Musa alayhi salam is Nabi, prophet, and he's a believer. Not like those who are living at Medina of the Jew who they didn't follow the teaching of Musa and they didn't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they are more, Musa more closer to the Muslim. In fact, he's one of a believer. This is why he, the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, commanded the Sahaba, the followers, to fast that day. And the question is it must? I mean, fasting Ashura, at the beginning, it was must. And this is, you know, the way that Ramadan started, or the fasting of Ramadan started, or the ibadah, the act of worship of fasting started. Before Ramadan, there was only one day which is obligatory to fast, which is the day of Ashura. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to fast the month of Ramadan, the whole Ramadan, then it was changed, so it's become optional and that's not obligatory as before. And it is recommended for the Muslim, the believer, when he fasts the day of Ashura, that he fasts one day before it or one day after it. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, لَإِنْ عِشْتُ مِنْ قَابِلْ لَأَصُومَنَّ التَّاسِعِ. If I live the next year, then I will fast the 9th. That's mean the 9th and the 10th. This is to differentiate ourselves from the Jew, the people of the book. So we're not resemble or imitating them in this ibadah. So it is recommended for the Muslim to fast one day before it or one day after it and fast the day of Ashura. But if the Muslim, the person, is not able to fast before or after, no harm that he fast at least the day of Ashura. And what was the answer? What's the difference between the day of Ashura or fasting Ashura and fasting Yawm Arafah, the day of Arafah? Fasting the day of Arafah, as we said, expiation for 2 years, the year before and the year that will follow, the coming year and the year before. But fasting Ashura is expiation for previous year. So there is difference between these two days. But now the question, when we said yukaffir, look at this Arabic word, yukaffir. And yukaffir from the word kaffara, kaffara. And the kaffara from Arabic word or Arabic verb, it's kafara. And from this we say kuffar and kafir, kafara. they translated as disbelief. Kafara in Arabic, in fact, means to cover. So maybe this the word cover in English, its roots from Arabic, because it's kafar. Why it's kafar? This is the meaning of kafara. Kafara does mean to cover. Cover, because it's called kafara, because that when you hide something. This is why in the Quran, mention about farmers as kuffar. See, that when talk about kuffar, here we are not meaning the disbeliever, but the farmer called kafir. Why? Because he, in fact, he hides the seed in the soil, so he covered it with sand or with some of the soil. So they're called kafara. So this is the meaning of kafara. So you kafir, that's mean to cover the sin, to cover the sin. You kafir, that's mean to cover the sins of the previous and the next year. And when it's covered, that's mean by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, it will not be written, or it will be written, but you will not be accountable for. That's mean it was forgiven. So this is one way of forgiveness. Now the question here that may ask, does this mean that this type of deeds like fasting the day of Ashura and fasting the day of Arafah will expiate all sin, minor and major, or only just minor? Ulama have different view regarding this. Some of them, they said this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here, he didn't put any condition or limit, or he didn't give any detail. He said it will expiate the sin of previous year and the following year. And about Ashura to expiate the previous year. So he didn't mention this sin, if it is minor or major. So some ulama, they said it's expiation for all type of sin. But on the other side, there are some ulama, they said this is a general statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about expiation, but we should take it or understand it in the light of other narrations. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talk about salah, for example, or between about jum'ah, min al-jum'ati ila al-jum'ah, from one Friday to the next Friday, that expiation for sins that committed between these two jum'ah. Wa min al-salati ila al-salah, and from one salah to another salah, there's expiation. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned there that expiation for sin if the person avoid committing major sin. So look at this condition here. Avoiding not committing major sin, which means that when the Prophet ﷺ, he talk about Friday, expiation between one Friday to the next Friday, and from one Salah to the next Salah, this he mentioned that this is only limited for what? For minor sins. How did we understand this? Because he said, مَجْتُنِبَتْ الْكَبَائِرِ. If the person avoid, he didn't committed any of the major sin. Now, here's the question. So, but here in Arafah and in Ashura, he didn't mention this. He didn't say if one, he stay away from major sin. But the ulama said that this hadith, we understand it in the light of other hadith. This hadith is am, general. And that one is specific. That means very specific about the meaning of and the concept of sin. Therefore, we understand it in the light of that sin. Their argument, look at this argument. They said, because if Friday or praying Friday will expiate the sin, and Friday is faridah, it is obligation, it is must, and the salah is rukun, pillars. So how come we talk about Salah, which is Rukun, about Salatul Jum'ah, which is Rukun, and then we say those expiate only minor sin, while we are talking about optional, not obligation, like Arafah and fasting of Arafah and fasting of Ashura, it's not obligation. So how come this, which is voluntarily and optional, you see, day or action will expiate major and minor? So just to conclude from this, according to the sound view, that whenever there is anything which talk about expiation, مكفرات الدنوب, this always understood related to the minor sin. Right? How about major sin? Major sin need tawbah, need repentance, need a person to make special repentance for that specific major sin that he committed. So this is the rule that if the person made or committed a major sin, then he need to repent. And you know, there is certain pillars and condition for tawbah, that the person should first of all, this is the way of tawbah, of repentance. First of all, to give up right away, not wait. Second, he determined not to commit it again. That means he determined in his heart, in his mind, and planned this, that he will never go back and do it again. He regrets what he did. That he feels sorry for the sin that he committed. And he feels sad that he did it. And regret what he did. And if this type of sin relate to the rights of other people, other party, you know, not, you know, that person committed for himself, like drinking or something doing that relate to his sin, like missing salah. If it was related to the rights of other, the fourth condition is to be added, which that he should go back to those people that he took their rights and giving them their rights. So this is very important to understand. So repentance is related to what? To major sin, while all these types of expiation is expiation for what? For the minor sin. And then the Prophet ﷺ was asked about the day of Monday. O Prophet of Allah, how about why? They asked him, why you are fasting the day of Monday? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to fast the day of Monday. So he said, that day, the day of Monday, is the day where I was born. Where I was born. And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was born on Monday. Right? And the day that I received revelation and I was sent. In fact, the ulama of hadith, they said, the narrator, he is not sure about this part. So it's not, it doesn't mean that, as it's mentioned and it translated here, that the day that I was sent and I was received revelation. No, it is one of them. But because the narrator, he was not sure which one is it. Did he say the day that I was sent or the day that I was received revelation? So he mentioned both words. Right? Is there a difference between them? Yes, there are. So if we said that the day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received revelation, that means received unzila alayh, that means the Quran was revealed to him, it's not the same day that he was sent as a messenger. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the beginning, he received the Quran, right? And this what we call it, he nubbi'a bi'iqra. That means when Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed to him, iqra, bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, he became prophet. But he is not carrying, he was not commanded to declare the message. And then he carried the responsibility as a messenger. And as you remember, there's difference between prophet and messenger. Right? When he was sent as a messenger, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to declare da'wah to the people, when Allah azza wa jalla said, "Asda' bima tu'mar wa 'arid 'an al-mushrikeen," and Allah, "Wa andhir 'ashiratika al-aqrabin," when Allah azza wa jalla commanded him to call people to Islam, then he became messenger after he was a prophet only. So this is just explanation for the wording of this hadith. طيب. Is it okay to fast this day? And we say that we fast days because the Prophet was born at that day. Yes, this is Sunnah. Why? Because we're following the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Unfortunately, there are some people, they took from this, as they take it as a proof of the celebration of the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they said, you see, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam celebrated Monday because he was born at that day. And this if we talk about in reality, it's not right. It's not correct. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ did not celebrate by party, by yearly the same day that he was born. But he mentioned that fasting Monday as a way of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is why he fasts. Same way as he was asked about fasting the day of Thursday, he said that is the day when the deeds is shown or presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want to, at the time that my deeds, my good deeds is shown to Allah Azza wa Jal, that at time while I'm fasting. So this is reasoning to encourage us, but we cannot take this as proof or as dalil that it is okay or it is sunnah to celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not a correct conclusion from this. Right. Let me see if... So we learned from this hadith, my dear brothers, many benefits. First of all, look about the questions that they were asked to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to show you that the Sahaba, the companions, the Muslim at that time, they are very careful. They are caring about asking to learn. You see, they are asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to show you how much they care about the Islamic knowledge. And also we say that seeking knowledge is one, in fact, of the most important good deeds for the Muslim. In fact, seeking knowledge, the knowledge of the deen, in fact, sometimes it is must. Sometimes certain part of the knowledge, it is must. Any knowledge that you need to practice your religion and to do your ibadah or to do your rights to Allah or to others, then it become must. This is fardu ayn. Like, for example, purification, how to clean or purify from janaba, how to perform wudu, how to pray the salah, all these, or how to perform hajj. This is must that every Muslim should know. Why? Because you cannot pray correctly or perform hajj or umrah unless you learn. How about the zakah? This depends. What type of wealth do you have? If you are a farmer, then it is must on you to study and understand and learn about the zakah of the agriculture, about farming. If you are a businessman, then you should also study to know what is the rules that control or the Muslim should follow when he gives the zakah of his wealth. As we are, ordinary people, at least know the zakah of the money that you can save. Because every one of us, one day or one time in his life, he may have some extra, at least, he can save from his salary, from any income. So it's happened. Therefore, it is must in the Muslim to know the minimum of the zakah. This is why it is the general rule that it said, ما لا يتم الواجب إلا به فهو واجب. Anything that cannot be done, any obligation that cannot be done without knowing other or doing other matter, then that matter which was optional maybe, it's become must. And this is why we said learning the knowledge of the deen is must, and the highest and the most honorable act of worship is seeking knowledge and sharing knowledge and teaching knowledge. In fact, teaching and learning knowledge, even it's more in ajr, in reward, than optional salah sometimes. Why? Because when you pray or when you fast, you benefit your own self. But when you learn, when you teach, you benefit yourself and also save others from ignorance. You teach others also, and you help them to understand. So this is the point here that we should realize. I just hold for a second to change the battery of my mobile now. So this is one of the benefits that we learned from this hadith, that the Muslim should always care about asking knowledge. So they all ask, and you remember I mentioned one time, asking is one of the best way of learning. Because when you ask, you concentrate to know what the answer and the matter that you ask about, you will never forget. You know, maybe you may listen to a lecture, you may listen to a lesson, you attend the class, but for sure that the point that you ask the teacher about, you will never forget it. Why? Because you were thinking about it, you were planning in your mind, and then you want to get more knowledge about it. So this is very important. And this is what was I mentioned before to you, that Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, when they ask him, how come you become Hibrul Ummah, you become the scholar. Even he was young at the time of the Prophet, he was only 10 years old. And then he became one of the greatest scholars of Islam. He said, بِقَلْبٍ عَقُول وَلِسَانٍ سَأُول. Look at this. قَلْبٍ عَقُول وَلِسَانٍ سَأُول. قَلْب, that means I comprehend and concentrate and, you know, dedicate my attention to learn. This is one. What is the other reason? وَلِسَانٍ سَأُولٍ, and my tongue that always ask. Asking scholars, ask about anything that I don't know. So it's very important. And unfortunately now, many of the Muslim, you know, students, you know, even in lectures, even they don't ask. That doesn't mean that we push everyone to ask any question. We don't mean this. But maybe they are shy, maybe they hesitate, maybe they don't know how to ask, but this is one of the way of learning. Barakallahu fikum. And this is why, to show you that the Sahaba, they care about what? About the Sunnah, and they don't want to do anything which will be considered as bid'ah. Let's go now to the next hadith. Can you see it?
Not yet, Sheikh.
Okay.
Yeah. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever fasts during the month of Ramadan, we can roll it up, Sheikh.
Amen.
Whoever fasts during the month of Ramadan and then follows it with 6 days of Shawwal will be rewarded as if he had fasted the entire year. Related by Muslim.
Right. Now this is another optional time for fasting, which is highly recommended. This is the hadith that was narrated by Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, that he said, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man sama Ramadan, the one who fasts Ramadan, thumma atba'ahu, then, atba'ahu, follow it by 6 days of Shawwal, faqad sama ad-dahr aw kana ka siyam ad-dahr, that's meaning as he was, he fasted the whole year. But before I come to this hadith, I just remember to mention one point regarding about the fasting of Arafat. And it's good that I remember by the, alhamdulillah, the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. the question that maybe some people ask about fasting the day of Arafah. Is it okay for the person who is performing Hajj to fast also the day of Arafah? Or this is only for those who are not performing Hajj? In fact, it is recommended to fast the day of Arafat only for those who are not in Hajj, who are not in Hajj. So the person, in fact, that if he is in Hajj, he should not fast the day of Arafat. Why? So he become strong and he is able to carry on the obligation of Hajj. It is not an easy journey. Regarding Ramadan, this hadith, it said, whoever fasts 6 days after Ramadan, but also he put condition. What is it? That to fast Ramadan first. So the person, the Muslim, is encouraged if he fasts the whole Ramadan, full Ramadan, then he starts fasting 6 days after Ramadan in Shawwal. Shawwal is the following month of Ramadan. Right? Is it must to be fasted one in a row, that means 6 days together, or he can divide these days throughout the month? For example, he fasts on the weekend because he's working. So when it's come the weekend, he fasts 2 days. By the end of the month, he will cover the 6 days. He can fast some one and then he leave. The most important thing that he finish it before the end of Shawwal. If there is a person who was in a journey, for example, traveler, or he was sick, and he missed some days from Ramadan, so what should he do? Should he first, he said, well, I can't fast Ramadan, and I mean make up for these days any day of the year, but I cannot catch these days in Shawwal. So he started with intention that he will fast the 6 days of Shawwal, but still there are some days of Ramadan that he didn't fast. So we said, if we apply this hadith, then it's not valid. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said, man sama Ramadan, who fasted Ramadan, and he didn't finish the fasting of Ramadan yet. Therefore, the person who missed any days of Ramadan, the first thing that he should do after Ramadan is to fast the day that he missed before he start the 6 days of Shawwal. So this is very important to understand, because some people, they may confuse about this. So first of all, do the obligation, and then you can go to the next one, which is the optional or voluntary. Right. What does it mean entire year? How come a person who fasts only 6 days after Ramadan, as he fasted the whole year? Because as you know, it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Muslim, the believer, he do one good deed, it will be counted for him 10 times as good deeds. 10 good deeds. So when you fast Ramadan, which is full month, it will be counted for you as what? As 10 months. And when you fast 6 days, 6 days of Shawwal, and every day is 10, that means 60 days, which means 2 months. And the year is what? The whole year is 12 months. So this is why it said as he fasted the entire year. And this to show you that how much it is very nice and good for the Muslim to fast. Now, some people, they ask, is it good to fast it at the beginning of the month, at the end, at the middle? In fact, if you can do it early, this is better for many reasons. First of all, for any good matter that you want to do, it is we were encouraged to hasten. That means to do it as soon as we can, because we didn't know what will happen to us, to take advantage from the time. Nobody knows if you will live to the end of the month or not. So this is one reason. The other reason is that you just come out from Ramadan. So you already get used to fasting for 30 days or 29 days. So when you fast after it, you know, right away, you will not feel that different. But if you stay for 10 days or 20 days, and then you want to return again to fasting, then you'll find that something which is a little bit difficult. But we must here mention that it is not lawful, it is forbidden to fast the day of the Eid, the day of the Eid. The two Eid, it is not right for the Muslim to fast them. Eid al-Adha, Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha. These 2 days, it is not lawful, it is forbidden for fasting. No one can fast. Even the one who missed some days of Ramadan, if he want to make up for these days, he cannot make it in the day of Eid. So this is very important to realize regarding this. And this, inshallah, and this is a great reward that, alhamdulillah, you will get the reward of fasting the whole year. This is يعني نعمة from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next hadith,
Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no servant of Allah fast on a day merely for the sake of Allah, except that Allah pushes the hellfire 70 years further away from his face due to fasting on this day. Agreed upon, and the wording is from Muslim.
Now, this hadith to show you, subhanAllah, the value of fasting. The value of fasting. How it is very highly يعني rewarded act of ibadah. يعني just remember that the reward of the fasting is unknown, which means countless. Just remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the hadith Qudsi, illa الصوم فإنه لي وأنا أجزي به. That fasting is for me. Fasting is for me, and I am the one who will decide the reward for it. How about other ibadat? Who is give the reward? Allah Azza wa Jalla give the reward, but He put us a standard. He give us like guideline to know about the reward. So He said, the one when he do one good deed, he will be given 10 deeds. How about fasting? This is for me. So how much Allah will give? We don't know, but always, what do you expect from the generous, subhanahu wa ta'ala? The most generous, Allah Azza wa Jal, when He said that I will give you, this is for me, and I will give you the reward. That means reward that you will never imagine, beyond your imagination. This is to show you how much, you know, fasting is very important, with very high value. So the Muslim, if he can fast as many days as he can, that's great. Because fasting one day will distance the person away from the hell for 70 years, the distance. That means it is very great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, the Muslim, whenever he gets chance, especially when a time of winter, you know, the time of winter, the day is very short. The hours of the day is less. While the day, the summertime, it is very long. I'm talking about our area here, the Middle East, Arabia, this area. You see, the day of the winter is very short. And I'm assuming that in everywhere. The days of the winter are very short. This is why the ulama said, الشِّتَاءُ رَبِيعُ الْمُؤْمِنِ نَهَارُهُ قَصِيرٌ لِلصِّيَامِ فيصوم وليله طويل فيقوم, which means the the shita, the winter time or winter season, this is the spring season for the believer. This is the high season for the believer. Why? They said because its days are short, so he can pass. Its nights are long, so he can stand in qiyam, in salah. So this is why it is very important to take an advantage of this time. Let's go to the next hadith here.
Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha narrated The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast until one would say he never break his fast. That is, he never stop fasting. And he would abandon fasting at other times until one would say that he would never fast. And I never saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fast for a complete month except for the month of Ramadan. And I never saw him fast in a month more than he did in the month of Sha'ban, agreed upon, and the wording is from Muslim.
Hey, this to show you also there is another rules related to fast. First of all, when he said that the Prophet ﷺ used to fast, that we say that he never break his fast, which means that he fast for many days, fasting every day. So they said that he never break his fast. The one who is not always with him, and he see him maybe for for many days that he is fasting. And another time, he will abandon fasting, he will not fast. Just to show that, and then Aisha radiallahu anha explained and gave us, some guideline, and she said, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never fast whole month except Ramadan. So only Ramadan that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fast the whole month, which means that he didn't fast other months, complete month. And what month that the Prophet ﷺ, he used to fast more than other month, other than Ramadan? Sha'ban, which is the month that we are now. Now we are in the eighth month of the Islamic calendar, which is the month just before the month of Ramadan. At the end of this month, inshallah, Ramadan will start. This month is highly recommended for the believer to fast as many days as he can. This is our chance these days, especially the weather is nice. So if the Muslim try these days to fast as many days as he can, but not the whole month, because the Prophet ﷺ didn't finish the whole month. In some narration say, it said, كان يصوم شعبان. He used to fast شعبان. But that doesn't mean the whole Sha'ban, the whole month. See? So it's only that it lists with a few days. So, and this is one of the virtue of the month of Sha'ban. And since we are talking about the month of Sha'ban, let me just mention that in this month, some people, they started many bid'ah. Like, for example, and this is warning for brothers and sisters to be careful and aware. There are some people who celebrate the nine of the middle of Sha'ban, the night of the middle of Sha'ban. They celebrate it either by fasting that day, especially because it is the middle of Sha'ban, or they stand in prayer the whole night at that night, because at the middle of the Sha'ban, we say this is bid'ah. This is an evasion. There is no proof that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned or commanded or any of his Sahaba, they did this. And there's no correct hadith about this. There is one hadith which some people misinterpreted. The hadith and the most sound hadith regarding Sha'ban, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, at the night of the middle of Sha'ban, Allah Azza wa Jal, look at the creation. Look at his servant. And then he will forgive everyone. Everyone will be forgiven at that night by Allah Azza wa Jal, except two groups. Mushrik, disbeliever, he will not be forgiven. Wa mushahin. What does it mean, mushahin? Mushahin is a person who have dispute with his brother, his neighbor, his friend, his... So anyone who have dispute, he doesn't settle any dispute with his relatives or his classmate or workmate or neighbor or people around him. These two people who have dispute among them, those that Allah will not forgive them at that night. And this to encourage us always for what? To clear all our dispute before Ramadan. So before Ramadan, you should work hard to clear all dispute between you and your brothers. And this, so when it's middle of Sha'ban, when Allah Azza wa Jalla look at all the creation, you will be forgiven by the will of Allah, by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this hadith or this narration doesn't mean that we make that day a special day, either by fasting or celebration. So we should be careful about this. There's other narration also that, which is sound, in fact, that there is prohibited to fast after the mid of Sha'ban. People, they said, okay, this hadith show that after 15th of Sha'ban, we cannot fast optionally because the Prophet ﷺ commanded not to fast. This is, in fact, hadith. Their ulamas have different view regarding what is the real meaning of this hadith. This to show that if the person, he intend not to fast except just few days before Ramadan. They say this is, it's not recommended. And you know, it's not lawful for the Muslim to fast the day of Ashak. That's mean the day of doubt, which is the last day of Sha'ban. This is forbidden to fast. Why? Because this is a day of doubt that it could be Ramadan or could be Sha'ban. This is haram. But if you fast, if you want to fast, you know, even after the 15th, no problem. But before Ramadan, a few days, you break your fast. So this is to show these are something which is related to the month of Sha'ban. Any innovation, any bid'ah, any celebration that you see, all type of this are bid'ah, and the Muslim should stay away from the bid'ah. Nah. But let's finish with this hadith. Nah. Abu Dhar
radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to fast for 3 days of every month, that is on the days of the full moon, the 13th, 14th, and 15th of the lunar month.
Right. It is recommended for the Muslim to fast 3 days every month. And as we said, if you fast 3 days in the month, that means as you fast the whole month. Why? Because as we mentioned before, if you fast 1 day with 10 hasanat, as you fast 10 days. So when you fast 3 days, it is equal as you fast 30 days, which is you fast the full month. SubhanAllah. And this is a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal. Therefore, it is recommended. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu said, Awsani Khalili Rasulullah bi salat. Abu Huraira said, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he advised me or gave me advice of 3 matters. But one of them, which is related to our subject, he said, وَأَنْ أَصُومَ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامٍ مِنْ كُلِّ شَهْرٍ, that I fast 3 days from every month. So the Muslim, if he train himself to fast these 3 days, that's good. Another narration, which is as in this, which you mentioned here, that it is recommended to fast the middle of the month, which is the 13th, the 14th, and the 15th. That the Muslim fast these 3 days. But if he missed, for example, he fasted the 13th, and then the 14th was Friday, or it was he has traveler, or he have hard work that he can fast, and he fasted later, no problem. Important thing that you cover these 3 days during the month. But it is highly recommended to be done during these 3 days, 13, 14, and 15. There's many different explanations about this. Some of them, they said, because when the moon, at that time, it is full moon. And when the full moon is, it has some effect on the behavior or the nervous of the people. But there's, I didn't read, in fact, very authentic proof about this, but this is something which some people said or try to explain the wisdom behind fasting these 3 days. Right, barakallah feekum, jazakumullah khair. I think we stop here. Inshallah, we'll meet next week, but we'll give you some time for your question. If you have any question, please go ahead and ask. And we prefer that we start with a question related to our subject. Now, if anybody have a question, he can raise his hand and the admin will give him a chance to unmute his mic and then he can ask his question. We have Sarah. Yes, Sister Sarah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Dr. Yahya.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, sister. Naam.
Yes, my questions. If I do fasting Monday and Thursday, and then this coming 13-14, it falls to Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. So if I fast also the Tuesday, it could be okay considered as my fasting, or what my intention if I fasting on that Tuesday?
No problem. As long as you see, you said that you used to fast, for example, yes, Monday and Thursday, and then yes, these 3 days is come in other days, like Tuesday, Wednesday, or Sunday, and no problem that you can fast all of them. And if it's come, you know, in the same day, you know, it is the 15th, and at the same time, it is Thursday or Monday, with the intention that you have that you use to fast this day, then inshallah, and by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, you are rewarded, inshallah, that for the intention of fasting Thursday as Thursday, and also for fasting these 3 days as mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So it is okay, and may Allah Azza wa Jal accept and reward you. Now.
Jazakallahu khairan, Dr. Yahya.
Okay, Shanabaz. Shanabaz, tafadhal. Go ahead, brother. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Shaykh, regarding that hadith on Abu Musa al-Khudri, that if we fast and for 70 years, the hellfire will be the away from us, which it is related to any day fasting that we do, example in a weekly Monday and Thursday. So any fasting, or it is suggesting to any particular fasting like Ramadan or that's the question, Shaykh.
No, this is optional. This is, my brother, optional fasting any day of the year that you fast, because the hadith said man sama yawman lillah, man sam, whoever fast one day. So this is not mentioned because talking about Ramadan or talking about these 6 days or the 3 days. Any day of the year that you fast, inshallah, the Muslim will get this reward. But also we should understand, my dear brothers, that there are certain days which is forbidden to fast. There are certain days which is recommended to fast. There are some days, so the Muslim should be aware of this. Like, for example, Ayam al-Tashriq, and it's coming, inshallah, with us. This is the days that we don't fast, which is the 3 days after Eid al-Adha, 11, 12, 13. It is not the days of fasting. So the Muslim should not fast, especially except those who are in Hajj and they cannot give the hadith. This is other alternative for them. So when we talk about fasting day, and it's not mentioned or labeled with any special thing, then that's mean any days of the year. Now.
JazakAllah khair, Shaykh.
Muhyiddin, unmute your mic, please, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. Yes. Nice to see you after a long time.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahlan ya Muhyiddin. Naam.
Shaykh, I want to ask a question on behalf of one of my friends. He has posted this question on the Seeking Knowledge group, but I think he has not got an answer. Can I ask the question? It is not on fasting, it is on zakah.
No problem. We already, you know, question that posted in our group, Seeking Knowledge group.
Maybe you have,
in fact, we answer it. Sometimes we don't answer it right away. You see, but we always, alhamdulillah, give it. But go ahead, answer. You ask maybe our brothers and sisters here in the benefit. Go ahead.
He says, if a person has invested in an apartment building which is still under construction, do we have to pay zakah on the advance payment made?
Advance payment for what?
No, actually, he has gone. He's one of my friends. He has invested on an apartment. It is under construction. So he's asking for the amount he paid, the advance payment he paid for that apartment, which is still under construction. Does he need to pay zakat on that money?
Is this money transferred already to the other party, or he is holding this?
No. He has already paid that advance amount to the
okay, as long as it's paid, it's come out from him. I mean, it's not anymore. It's his money. Then there's no zakah in this.
Zakah. So I will. Shall I post the answer, or will you post it in the group, Sheikh, or shall I post it on behalf of you?
No problem. I will give more detail. I will answer this question in more detail in the group, inshallah. I'll do it.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. I appreciate
it. Barakallah fik. Na'am. Any other question? Or we stop because it is Isha time. Jazakumullah khair, brother Abdul Majid. May Allah reward you for your help and care for all the classes that we have. And may Allah reward all brothers and sisters here with us. And may Allah Azza wa Jal, who gather us together here to learn, He gather us together, inshallah, and the hereafter in the highest paradise. Jazakumullah khair. Wa sallallahu sallam wa barak ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullah khair, Sayyidina.